Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 30th meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2023. We've received apologies from Karen Adam, MSP, and a welcome to the meeting, Emma Harper, MSP, who will be substituting. Before we begin, can I remind those committee members using electronic devices to please switch them to silent. Our first item of business this morning is to decide whether to take item 9, consideration of evidence taken on the welfare of dogs, Scotland Bill and private. Are members agreed? Thank you. Our second item of business today is consideration of the draft Quality Meat Scotland Amendment Order 2023. And I welcome to the meeting Mary Goujon, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands, and our officials, and Michelle Cahoon, Head of Livestock Products Policy, and Mairead McCrory. And Mairead McCrossan, the lawyer from the Scottish Government, and invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement.
Good morning, and thanks so much for inviting me to speak about the Quality Meat Scotland Amendment Order 2023. The Quality Meat Scotland Order 2008 makes provision about the constitution and function of the organisation, and it also specifies the rules around the rates for the red meat levy. The rates included in the order are the maximum rates which can be charged, and QMS sets the payable levies annually with my approval within those ceilings. The order stipulates that QMS can't increase the paid levy in the excess of the maximum levy rate that's in the order, and contravention of this requirement would be an offence. The maximum rates haven't been amended since the order was first laid in Parliament in 2008. Since then, there's only been one increase in the payable rates. That was in 2010, when cattle increased from £4.57 to £5.50, sheep from 67 pence to 80 pence, and pigs increased from £1.05 to £1.26. These figures are the combined producer and slaughterer levy. This change took the sheep rate to the maximum, and it only left 9 pence headroom on pigs. Levy income is, of course, fundamental to the running of QMS, who provide several functions to the benefit of the red meat sector. Now, I don't have time to cover all of QMS's activity, but one of the functions that I would like to highlight today is their marketing of Scotch beef, Scotch lamb and specially selected pork, which is so important for Scotland's red meat industry, as well as for raising the profile for the export market. It's important to ensure that QMS have the ability, with the agreement of industry, to raise the payable levy if they feel that there is a need for that. This draft instrument amends the Quality Meat Scotland Order 2008 for this purpose. Final approval on any rise in the payable levy is required from ministers. And I would like to reiterate that the maximum levy rates are being raised due to the current payable sheep rates having reached the ceiling permitted by the order, and the pig levy being just 9 pence away from the limit. The changes provided for by the new SSI will ensure that the order will meet the needs of the sector for a number of years ahead. Raising the maximum rates in the order does not mean that the payable rates will automatically increase. In giving my approval for any subsequent proposed increase in payable rates, I will have to be satisfied that QMS has fully engaged with levy payers, that stakeholder views have been heard, and that the impact of the rise has been considered. Levy is fundamental to the running of QMS, and I'm content that this amendment to the order is necessary. So I hope that my comments today are helpful in setting out the rationale for bringing forward this instrument. So with that, I'm of course happy to take any questions that the committee might have.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I'm going to kick off with a couple of questions. It's my understanding that the levy hasn't been, or the ceilings for the levy haven't been looked at since 2010. Now, that's quite some time ago. So why are we only seeing this now when the sheep levy is at its maximum? Why isn't this reviewed on a regular basis? So potentially any increase would be smaller than it needs to be now, and just give farmers more certainty. 13 years is a long time to wait, and then it looks like it's been done at the last minute because you've reached the top of the available charge you can make for sheep in particular.
Yes, well, just to be clear, the ceiling was set in 2008, but the last time that the levies were raised, you're absolutely correct, was in 2010. But again, the levies are set on an annual basis, which is something I have to approve. And again, that's up to QMS to bring that forward, to consult on any changes to the levy as well. I agree that it has been a long time, which is why I think it's only right then that we consider those ceiling rates and why we're bringing forward the proposals that we are today for the committee's approval, because I think clearly a lot has happened within that time, and I think we're all seeing and experiencing the impacts of inflation, and we've seen some sizeable challenges that right across the industry that they've faced over the course of the past few years. So I think that's where it is right that we look to increase the ceilings, but also make sure that we're future-proofing that, again, in case, well, should QMS want to raise the levy, should they consult with members, and that's ultimately what levy payers agree to, and that they have, we have that ability and that flexibility there in the future too.
Okay. So to understand that this is just providing the maximum levy, but was there any reason why it's not been reviewed more frequently? And is it something that you might do in the future so we're not looking at this legislation only coming forward every 10 years? And because when you look at the current maximum levy and the proposed, it's a big increase, which has some stakeholders have raised some concerns over that. But if it was raised every 2 years or every 5 years, that ceiling might not rise quite so much. Is there any reason why you didn't review it more often than, as I say, it's 13 years since this was first discussed?
Again, I would just make the point that, you know, it is the ceiling rather than the maximum rate. So, again, QMS would have to have that consultation with levy payers to see if they are going to increase the levy. You know, there's not a guarantee in any way with that. But ultimately, that is a discussion that QMS needs to have with levy payers in relation to the rates. And again, that is looked at and considered annually.
But the only time the Parliament can look at this is this once every 13 years, because we'll have no role whatsoever when it comes to QMS engaging with their stakeholders and you as a minister to decide where any increase is valid or not. So that's the reason I'm asking, because this is the last time we will get to see this legislation before potentially QMS could put the levy up from £5.25 to £9. And I'm not expecting them to do that, because I hear what you're saying, but this is the last time we get to look at it. That also brings into the question why there wasn't a BRIA on this. Now, I know you responded to a question to say that there's no effect currently by this instrument, but ultimately will down the road have a financial impact, and once again the Parliament will have no role in that. So why wasn't there an analysis done of the potential impact of this levy increase so that the committee could consider that?
Well, one thing I would say that I want to make sure that we are absolutely clear in what we're talking about today, because I think the last thing I would want to put the fear into the industry that they're going to see levy rates increase to the absolute maximum in the ceiling. This is a technical order. We're raising the ceiling. The levy rates aren't being increased. And again, it comes back to, this is up to QMS, the discussion that they have with their levy payers about whether or not that levy rate would rise. It then comes to Scottish ministers for approval, as it does annually and as I've set out. In relation to the BRIA, of course, it would have been very difficult for us to prepare. And as you've already set out, convener, I wrote to the committee and outlined why we didn't undertake a BRIA, purely because it would have been speculative. There is no proposal right now on the table for an increase in levy rates. We don't know if that will happen, what any proposals will be, so it's not possible for us to give that definitive impact or say that there would be a direct impact on businesses when we don't know if the levy is going to rise or not.
Yeah, I appreciate that, but this is the last time we can look at it. So we're about to approve a potential increase up to a ceiling, absolutely understand that, but the Parliament and this committee has no role whatsoever in scrutinising when that levy may kick in or will kick in. So we will see an increase in the levies for cattle, sheep and pigs, but we'll not have any role in that, and we'll not be able to assess what the financial impact is. I think that's what I'm trying to get at. Do you see any role for this committee in the future when it comes to the ability of QMS and the Minister's Theresa Levy?
I mean, I think the roles and responsibilities in relation to that are what's set out in the legislation, which is why I'm before you today in relation to this order and raising the ceilings. But I'm more than happy to keep the committee updated if QMS decide that, you know, they're undertaking engagement across the country just now with different events to discuss this, as well as their wider strategy with industry. Again, that's a discussion that they need to have. We will be informed and approached if they are then considering raising the levy. And of course, I'd be happy to keep the committee updated.
Okay, thank you. I've got questions from Rachel Hamilton, Kate Forbes, and then Jim Fairley.
Morning, Cabinet Secretary. We had two responses to the government consultation. It's not exactly a solid basis to proceed with this technical amendment. Would you agree?
Well, I think that what's key here is who was consulted. And there was the fact that there was the follow-up discussions with the two people who responded to the consultation as well, because I think it's really critical that we engage with the people who would be most impacted by this too, which are the processors. There was also a response from NFUS. There were then follow-up discussions and meetings with the two organisations as well to discuss the concerns that they had about the order. But again, this is about their discussions also with QMS should the levy rates be raised. But again, what we are talking about here is a technical order and raising the ceilings. And that was the discussion that we had. But I don't know if Michelle would want to say anything further on that.
Yeah, I think just to say as well, while it's two responses we had, each of those two organisations have very many members. So there were therefore many more organisations reached as a result of those two.
It's interesting because I was at an event with farmers when our committee survey had been sent out, which unfortunately it was just a little bit too late, I think. But we did our due diligence because we wanted to understand a little bit more. But I understand that you handpicked the people that you sought an opinion from. Is that true? Because farmers weren't aware of it.
Targeted consultation.
What is a targeted consultation? How do you handpick those people?
In consultation with QMS and our own knowledge, we made sure that we reached levy payers. NFUS cover farmers, SAMW cover processors. So those were the two respondents.
So it's up to them to speak to their members.
But I would also say as well that that's not an unusual approach. I mean, we do take that approach with other consultations that are held in relation where there are specific interests that we need to consult and hear from as well. So again, that's not an unusual approach. And again, just to be clear, it was about the ceiling, not the increase in levy, because that's a discussion that QMS need to have with the levy payers.
And do you believe that the consultation process should have followed the detailed engagement from QMS to understand what the levy payers actually believe about this particular raising of the ceiling?
Sorry, I don't understand what you
do
mean.
Do you think that it would have been a better route to ask QMS to do detailed engagement prior to the consultation process so that QMS levy payers could have understood that this was coming forward, and so we would have got a broader understanding of what they felt about it?
I think it was important that we undertook the consultation on the raising of the ceiling, and that, again, I think is quite rightly a separate process to then the consideration of the raising of the levy itself, because they're very distinct processes too. So I think it's important that we set out that process and have undertaken that in the way that we have.
And does the increase in the possible increase in the levy, the raising of the ceiling, correlate directly to the increase in operational costs to QMS, or is it directly responsible for the marketing of Scotch beef?
Again, this is about the ceiling and future-proofing that for years to come. So there was a methodology that was taken by QMS. I don't know if Michelle would be able to say a bit more about that in considering what the appropriate ceiling rates might be. So considering the consumer price index, retail price index, the agricultural agricultural price index as well, looking at the averages over the course of the past 10 years and how that has changed, and looking at, well, how can that be future-proofed, say, for the next 10 years at least, to give that flexibility. And again, this is all about the ceiling, not what any rate could potentially be. But I would also want to highlight as well that we aren't the only government going through this process, or the only agency going through this process. The same discussions are also taking place across the rest of the UK. It's happening in England and it's happening in Wales as well, in relation to looking at the ceiling rates for their own levies there.
So just looking at the answers that you gave to the convener with regards to looking at this technical raising of the ceiling over the last 13 years, is it coincidence that it's occurring now, or is it related to the inflationary cost burden on QMS?
Well, I think, as I've highlighted already, there have been a number of challenges over the course of the past few years. We've seen inflation soar, which is why I think it's important that we are considering this now, especially when we see that the sheep and the costs related to that are at the absolute ceiling. Pigs are only 9 pence away from what the maximum could be. So that doesn't leave any leeway should their QMS, in discussion with their levy payers, decide that there needs to be a change in order to enable them to carry out their activities ultimately, because the levy is so fundamental to the running of the organisation.
So do you have any oversight as the Scottish Government to, obviously it's a government organisation, government-funded organisation. Do you have any oversight as to whether the ceiling will be raised, the levy will be consulted on, and the extra revenue will be used for operational activities to take into account inflationary burden, or whether they will be directed to marketing, directly correlated to marketing activities to promote Scotch beef, which a lot of farmers are concerned about?
Mm-hmm. Well, first of all, to say that they're not a government, QMS aren't a government-funded organisation, but they do have audited accounts that are published annually as well, where that information can be interrogated by the committee or any member of the public if they want to.
Sorry,
if they want to have a look at that.
All right, I thought that they were government-funded.
No, and again, that's why the levy is so critical in relation to that as well. In terms of the process from here. Now, as I say, the levy is considered annually, on an annual basis, so even where there's been no change to that levy, it still has to come to Scottish ministers for approval. And that's the process that will continue on as well. Now, when that comes forward, I would be expecting QMS to consult with the levy payers before they propose any increase, should they propose any increase. And I would expect to see evidence of that consultation and how they've had that engagement with stakeholders. Now, as I understand, that engagement has already started by QMS, that they're doing a roadshow across the country at the moment where they're discussing their strategy as well as discussing the levy too. So, of course, I will continue to have an interest in those discussions as they come forward and before any proposals are put to me.
Okay.
Just in the back, Rachel asked about the targeted consultation. Could you give us the list of people who were asked to respond to the consultation?
Yes, I'd be happy to provide that. I don't know if you want me to list them off just now. We have that information here.
That
I'd be happy
helpful.
To follow that up in writing.
No, if you could let us know what they are just now, that would be helpful. If you've
okay,
got
I'll pass
hand.
It to Michelle. She's got the list there.
Yeah. The National Sheep Association of Scotland, Scottish Beef Association, NFUS, Sam W, the Institute of Auctioneers and Appraisers in Scotland, Scottish Association of Young Farmers Clubs, Scottish Crofting Federation, Agricultural Industries Confederation, and the Scottish Craft Butchers.
And can you tell me who actually responded?
Yes, NFUS and Sam W.
Okay.
Scottish Association of Meat Wholesalers.
Yes.
Were you not surprised at the lack of responses? And was anything done to follow up on the organisations that didn't respond? Because we had a call for views on the back of this last week, and the Beef Association said that they found the email in a spam folder. Was there any attempt to ensure that everybody actually had this and had an ability to respond? Was there any follow-up? Because 2 out of 9 seems to be quite a low response.
Yeah, Legitimate as that question is, I cannot see how the Minister is responsible for the fact that an email went into someone else's spam folder.
Thank you, Alistair. I think I'll decide whether my question is valid or not. My question is, actually, if you've only got 2 out of 9 responses, was there any effort to try and get further responses, given this was a targeted rather than open consultation? I suppose that's the direction my question's coming from.
As I say, we followed up with the NFUS and SAMW. I'll ask Michelle about any further up correspondence we had with the other organisations.
We were content that the two organisations that did respond were representative of both producers and processors, and the timelines were tight.
Okay, why were the timelines tight?
It was ultimately to enable us to bring this forward. I mean, as we've already said, in terms of setting out the process, and it was important that we brought this forward to enable that time for scrutiny and the ceilings, and then enable the QMS to undertake the work and engagement that they need to do.
Okay. Thanks. Kate Forbes.
Thank you, and thanks to the Cabinet Secretary. I mean, it sounds very much to me like all of the questions about what happens to the levy after this technical instrument is passed should really be directed to QMS. And I took heart from what the Cabinet Secretary said this morning, but also what you've said in a previous letter, that you would expect QMS to fully consult as widely as possible and to engage with producers and processors before taking any action on the proposed increase. And obviously, many of these questions stem from a concern that it is hugely challenging for producers in particular right now to make any sort of margin on the industry. So I wonder if you could say something a little bit more broadly on A, what role you would expect QMS to take, and B, how the government is more widely supporting producers and farmers at a difficult time.
Absolutely, and I think it is a really important point there, because I think it's really important that we don't conflate or by any means confuse the different roles here and responsibilities in relation to this. So, as I say, we have the responsibility to bring forward this SSI in relation to setting the ceilings, to set the levy ceilings, but it is up to QMS to, if they want to raise that levy, to then have that consultation and that discussion with their levy payers, should they decide to do that, and then put forward those proposals to me ultimately for approval. But I think, and I'm sure the committee would agree, about the hugely valuable role that QMS undertake in terms of their marketing and promotion of red meat and everything that they do for our red meat industry. I've seen it firsthand myself in terms of the different trade fairs that they attend, what they're doing in terms of export and the value that they bring in for our red meat sector, which equates to the tens of millions annually in terms of their promotion, but also in terms of the strategy that, as I've outlined, they're consulting on and engaging with their members on at the moment, showing how they really are driving forward that sustainability for the red meat sector going forward, as well as considering a number of exciting different projects. But again, it's up to them. They need to have that discussion with their levy payers to show exactly what they're doing on their behalf and why that role is so critically important going forward.
And if I could follow, one of the respondents to the consultation said that a change in the levy ceiling within the order must not be taken by QMS as industry agreement to an increase in the levy rates paid, which I am assuming something you may agree with, but I don't want to put words in your mouth, because it is for QMS to determine that. And then secondly, we understand that although there's no requirement for QMS to consult, ministerial approval is still required at the start of each financial year, regardless of whether there's a change to the payable rates or not.
Yes, that's absolutely right. And I think in response to both of those points, that I would say that if any proposal comes forward to me about that, or there was any proposal about an increase in rates, I would be expecting QMS, and I would be expecting to see evidence that they have consulted and engaged widely with their members and with their levy payers about any proposed increase in rates or what that levy rate is going to be. So that's the very least that I would expect.
Thank you.
Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Convener. Obviously, Kate Forbes has just very eloquently asked all the questions that I had, so thank you, Kate. But what I would notice from the committee's own responses, we got we've got broad support across the industry for the right to be able to put the price up as and when, as long as that consultation happens. So I just thought it was worthwhile getting that on record. Thank you, Convener.
Absolutely. I've got a small supplementary from Rhoda and then Emma Harper.
Just on Kate Forbes's questions, there seem to be two points you're making. One, that there would have to be agreement from the industry for a price increase, and two, that there would have to be consultation with the industry. And the two things are not the same thing. Agreement is very different to consultation. I just want to know which is the correct response. Do the industry have to agree?
Well, I would, again, well, one thing I would expect to see is that there's that engagement and consultation with industry. And I think that's a given. I think they need to be consulted about any potential increase in the levy rate, which would be up to QMS to do. Of course, any proposals they bring forward, I would hope, would have that industry agreement. So at the moment, I can't speculate on what any potential decision might be or what that would look like. But I know that they have a strong relationship and are engaging with their levy payers as we speak at the moment, undertaking that engagement across the country too. So I would hope that they would, again, reach that overall agreement and consensus around what, if they were proposing to increase the levy, about what that should be.
OK, but it's not necessary.
Again, QMS would put a proposal to me and then it's up to Scottish ministers to agree that one way or another. Okay. So I'm just trying to set that out in terms of the overall process.
So do you have the ability to go back to QMS and say we're not satisfied at the consultation and we actually want to see approval from the stakeholders? Is that something you could do?
Again, I think we're going down all sorts of different roads here about and speculating about what might or might not happen. And again, we haven't been in that position in the past. The proposals are put to Scottish ministers for approval. Again, QMS are a responsible body and I know that they would be undertaking that engagement. And as I say, I know that's already started anyway. I don't think they need any prodding from me to be told to engage with the industry. And again, that is what they are doing just now. And of course, it's within their best interest to do that and to have that good relationship with levy payers.
No, absolutely. I'm not questioning the ability for QMS to do that. It was just that whether you had the power to go back on the back of Rhoda's question to say that, yeah, you've consulted, but we actually want to see an affirmative, a positive response from the industry that the increase in levy is acceptable.
I'm sure we would have these discussions with QMS, and I don't think it would be a case of... I think we're jumping automatically to what a negative situation might be, and I don't think we would be there at all. I think we have a very strong working relationship with QMS, and I know that QMS have that same relationship with their levy payers too, so that engagement from their side is important. So I don't imagine we would end up in that situation, to be honest.
OK, that's fine. Thanks very much. Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. I know I'm a substitute for this committee, but I just want to kind of bring it back right to the beginning. This is a technical amendment. It's just a technical bill. And I know that, like in my engagement with Quality Meat Scotland, they're competent, they're professional, they're responsible, they're diligent about working with the businesses and the farmers. And so, I would trust Quality Meat Scotland to do the correct engagement and everything like that. So I suppose my question is back to this is a technical amendment so that it allows Quality Meat Scotland to then go out and engage if levies are to be increased, which would be incrementally done over an annual engagement basis. Is that correct?
Yes, you're absolutely right. And I would just want to agree with everything that you said about Quality Meat Scotland. But again, that's a discussion that they then need to have. But you're absolutely right. This is technical. It's just raising the ceiling. It's not raising the levy, because that's a discussion that needs to happen and that QMS need to have with their levy payers.
OK, thanks.
Thank you. Just also, I don't think the committee was in any doubt exactly what this instrument was. Is there any more questions from members?
Just one. The QMS are likely to go out to review in another 5 years. What if they have reached the ceiling? Do we find ourselves in this position again and just, you know, go at it again if there are extreme market conditions? I mean, it is relevant that they have cited the inflationary pressures to implement this. So, you know, we may find ourselves in another position, but I suppose we just reach that bridge when we come to it.
Oh, yeah, you're absolutely right in that sense. But I think what we have tried to do with the ceilings that are proposed here is try and future-proof that so that we don't need to come back every year to have a look at the ceilings and decide whether they're at the appropriate level or not. As I say, there's been a variety of different factors that have come together in bringing forward the proposals for the ceilings at the rates that we've set out in the order today, which have taken into account all these different factors, looked at average over the course of the past 10 years to then try and project that forward as best as you possibly can to future-proof it. But of course, never say never. We don't know what's going to happen a few years down the line, but we do hope with the ceiling rates that are brought forward today that that does future-proof it to a certain degree.
Could I just clarify one other thing, please, Convener? The QMS were £1 million short. They had a shortfall of £1 million in their sort of workings out in terms of the levy and their activity. Did they raise that with you when they asked you to make this technical change?
That's not a discussion that I've had with QMS.
Okay, thank you.
Any further questions? No. There's just one point I'd like to raise on the policy note. So you are aware that the committee wrote to clarify some things. We just feel, or as convener felt, that the policy note was lacking in some information that could have been provided. You know, there wasn't any indication of what the proposed changes are or the history behind the policy. So just as a general note, and it's something we find quite often, there could be more detail in the policy note which would help the committee when we come to look at these SSIs. And this one could have easily have had a little bit more information to help the committee before we had to write and engage our clerks to investigate it. But Cabinet Secretary, thank you very much and officials for this morning. That's been hugely helpful. And we've got... sorry. Oh, yes. Of course, we've got the real business we've got to do. We've now had the discussion. We now move on to the formal consideration of the motion to approve the instrument and invite the Cabinet Secretary to move motion S6M11038.
Formally moved, Convener.
Does any member wish to debate the motion? No. Is the committee content to recommend approval of the instrument? Yes. Finally, is the committee content to delegate authority to me to sign off our report on our deliberations on this affirmative SSI? Thank you. That completes consideration of the affirmative instrument. And I thank the Cabinet Secretary and officials once again for the information she provided. Thank you very much. I'll briefly suspend to allow a change in the witnesses. Thank you. Our next item of business is an evidence session on the Welfare of Dogs Scotland Bill, with a member in charge of the bill, Christine Graham, joining us this morning. And we've scheduled 90 minutes for this session. And a welcome to the meeting, Christine Graham, MSP, the member in charge of the bill, Rose Thompson from the Non-Governmental Bill Unit, and Claudia Bennett, the Scottish Parliament Solicitor. And I'd like to invite Christine Graham to make an opening statement.
Well, thank you very much, Convener, and I welcome the opportunity to give evidence to the committee on my bill. I've been working with a wide range of organisations on the policy within the Welfare of Dogs Scotland Bill for the last 6 years. As the Minister highlighted in evidence, the breeders' licence scheme that the Government brought forward had its genesis in my previous member's bill from last session. The bill is therefore a reduced version of that former bill, but with the valuable addition of the certificate process to complement the code of practice. 6 years ago, I recognised the growth in supplies of puppies and dogs purchased online and from puppy factory farms, and considered what could be done to reduce this. I decided that if supply was the issue, the current legislation and policing was not sufficiently impacting on this then, perhaps I should then tackle demand, and that would approach supply. We all know there's a surge in the level of dog ownership across Scotland, exacerbated by COVID, and combined with a lack of an informed approach from the public to buying a dog, which I understand, led to a rise in unscrupulous breeding. It is therefore more urgent to ensure those thinking of getting a dog do so in an informed way. My bill is a valuable tool in the box, alongside other ongoing work set out by the Scottish Government in the Minister's evidence. The animal welfare issues, emotional distress, massive vet fees and high mortality rates from illegal puppy farming or buying a dog someone cannot care for has, I think, been well established to the committee. Evidence from key stakeholders supporting my bill demonstrates the scale of the issue. The SSPCA estimates the illegal puppy trade is worth £13 million in Scotland a year. Dogs Trust highlights the huge rise in problems arising from buying a dog, where it cannot be properly looked after, with abandonment rates rising. And I have to say, there was a programme this morning on the news where it was showing you abandonment rates still on the rise. With 96% of rehoming centres reporting an increase also in behavioural issues. Calls to the SSPCA helpline on giving up pets has quadrupled, with costs, vet care and inappropriate living conditions cited as common reasons. A recent survey found that only 29% of people considered cost when they got their pet. Dogs are the most frequently abandoned animal, and rehoming centres experience incredible pressures as a result. Battersea found only 5 to 10% of puppies across the UK are coming from licensed breeders who should ensure healthy puppies and appropriate new owners. It follows, therefore, that 95% of puppies are bought from unlicensed sellers, awareness of signs of unscrupulous breeding is low. A PDSA report found only 43% of dog owners knew a puppy should be seen with its mother. The SSPCA highlighted that 65% of owners found their pets online, with 2.5 million of associated fraud. 20% of puppies bought online fall ill or die within a year, according to government commissioned research. The Dogs Trust submission describes the purpose of the bill, and this is the purpose, as educating and, quote, educating and providing prospective dog owners with the tools to purchase or rehome a dog more responsibly and to identify and avoid any unscrupulous breeding practices, close quotes. That's what the crux of what this bill would achieve, to educate, to change the behaviours of the public, preventing so many of the problems I've just highlighted to you. That is why the general principles of the bill are supported by the clear majority of organisations submitting written evidence to you, including SSPCA, Scottish Animal Welfare Commission, Blue Cross, Dogs Trust, Battersea Dogs and Cats Home, and a number of local authorities. Now, two key points I want to make on the contents of the bill, if I may, Convener, before answering your questions. First, why do we need a code when the government could just revise and promote the old one, which I know has been raised? This code in this bill serves a very, very different purpose to the existing code. It will have a different appearance given its distinctive purpose. It applies to a different group of people, and it has a new certificate and associated process attached to it. It applies to people considering acquiring a dog. The existing code applies to people who already own one. The code in the bill and the certificate process would do additionally three key things. Make people think twice if they realise they can't afford one or it doesn't fit in with their lifestyle or living space. Secondly, help people to have more time to identify the right breed for them and their circumstances. And thirdly, help people assess the situation the puppy is being sold in to give them clear warning signs that they may be buying from the illegal puppy trade. The code will also be short and easily understood. It's a punchy checklist of key considerations. That will include the key questions I set out in my bill, contrasting with the existing code, which is a long reference document running to 28 pages linked to a wealth of other reference material. I want mine to be easily understood. Subsuming the contents of code I suggest into the existing code would mean the key considerations I'm seeing to get buyers to engage with would get lost and therefore have less prominence. Furthermore, the distinct purposes of the two codes would be diluted. Clarity would be lost. The code, therefore, would be less effective. I also want to emphasise, convener, the importance of the certificate. There is no certificate process associated with the existing code. The certificate seeks to ensure anyone buying a dog will reflect on the questions to be answered as part of that certificate. This will prompt them to reflect on the questions and, I hope, reflect further. The briefest considerations of those questions will give pause for thought, no pun intended, for those buying a puppy through online sales. The consideration of the cost, the breed, questioning why they cannot see the mother with a puppy and so on, as well asking them to sign it and confirm they understand the need to retain the certificate should the authorities have cause to see it. This is based on a process followed in France, where, as of 2022, a certificate is required when you buy a dog, indeed a number of other animals. Both my certificate and the French certificate also require the provider to sign the certificate, which creates a responsibility on the supplier to ensure the acquirer has gone through all the necessary steps in the checklist of questions contained in the certificate. Convener, I've listened carefully to the evidence you have received and the recurring themes in questions from members. On the point about the government being able to do the work required to create a new code without my bill, I'd say this. The policy work, drafting, consultation and scrutiny has already been undertaken. The government has made it clear it supports the code and the certificate process and has even considered how it would amend the bill at stage two. So how would asking the government to begin this work again be a good use of parliamentary government time or the time of the animal charity sector, amongst others, or indeed for the welfare of animals? In addition, the bill includes a legislative requirement from the code to be publicised. This, combined with an acknowledgement from the minister that the costs associated with this element of the bill seem entirely reasonable, gives assurances that the awareness raising will definitely happen. That is the key difference between a new successful code, a new certificate process, and the existing code, which has very low awareness levels amongst the public and has not been revisited or revised since 2010. I'm just coming to the end. Finally, I see the clerk looking rather agitated. Finally, in part two, members will have seen the letter I sent the minister last week. I'm wholly committed to the intention behind part two to improve traceability, so any dog being sold or transferred in Scotland needs to be on a searchable database. This would enable the public to take informed decisions when sourcing a puppy, and it would aid enforcement, making puppies sold out with either regime, including from the illegal puppy trade, far easier to identify. That said, if there is an alternative being actively pursued by the government through the use of microchipping, that would either deliver the benefits of part two by another means, then I think that would merit close consideration as a viable alternative to the register of unlicensed litters that I propose, especially given the government's indication to seek to remove part two by amendment at stage two. So I'm still arguing for it, but if it comes to push or shove about part two, then I would be content, if necessary, for the committee, if they wanted that to be removed about the register for the time being, I'd be content to say I would undertake to accept the government's amendment, subject to us moving on with a microchipping national database. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Ms Graham. I'm not going to accuse you of filibustering because we're still going to have 90 minutes of questions. But I believe you probably answered them all in your opening statement. But we'll get kicked off. Thank you for that. That's been really useful. Can I ask a very simple question? How would a voluntary code of practice on the responsible purchasing and selling of a dog actually in practice change behaviour?
Well, the certificate is not voluntary. The certificate would be, if the code of practice comes into being, the certificate is mandatory. And that is very useful for ensuring that people have read and understood what I think is quite a simple, I mean, they're very basic questions that most of us would ask ourselves, getting a puppy or a dog, so that people would have that. And that would require both the person who is transferring the dog and the person acquiring it to have seen and signed and say, we understand these conditions. But it's also useful to animal welfare organisations if at the end of the day an issue arises about welfare of the dog or whatever. Not punitive, if there's an issue. They can say, well, you do know you require the certificate, you know, and this is something that is. So As I emphasised throughout, it's not a punitive piece of legislation. It's to change public behaviour.
You touched on it being a lot about awareness. So is this just the certificate is in effect reassurance that you've read the instructions, so to speak. So you've taken the time to read something, yeah, and you've signed to do that. But given that most people will want to do the right thing by a pet, and there will always be people who just disregard common sense when it comes to responsible ownership. Will we not just get people ticking or signing a certificate without actually doing it, and it won't result in any benefit because it's voluntary?
Well, it's not voluntary in that sense. If I go to the bill itself, here we are at section 4. Before acquiring the dog, the prospective acquirer is to complete a certificate, not may complete a certificate. So it's mandatory. And it really is, many people do reflect, but there are too many people, for very good reasons, that don't reflect before they acquire animals. We see that by the number that are being abandoned, the number that are the vast criminal puppy trade, that's 2,500 for a dog, that's a puppy that's been brought often dreadful conditions, they're desperate, so it puts the price. I said at the beginning, what was the purpose? The purpose was to ensure that people think twice. And this, to me, is saying, well, I've got to look at this, and I have to complete a certificate relating to the matters mentioned in subsection 4. So I've got to go through all this. And it's a really think twice, thrice, four times before you do. Maybe at the end of that, you say, yes, I do want to get a dog, but I better not get that breed. Or I've got to go and see it with its mother. And not buy online, because there's a huge increase online. You know, little teddy bear puppies and things that are very popular. And the result is often puppies that are poorly bred, puppies that are poorly behaviourally trained, and puppies that come from really bad sources. So it really is all-round good egg stuff, as it were, for both the animal and the person getting it.
So do you think it would assist in the SSPCA? So if they did come across a case of where a dog's welfare hadn't been looked after properly, they could refer back to the certificate to say, well, you should have been aware that,
yes,
this type of dog, whatever, and would actually help in potentially prosecutions or animals being taken away or whatever to solve that. It would be an extra tool for the SSPCA.
It was actually the SSPCA that brought my attention to the French certificate. But it's not necessarily a prosecution or taking the dog away. It could just simply be a matter of educating. Uh-huh. So we must look at it as something that is additional to what they have. And as I say, the thrust of this is not punitive. The thrust of this is, please educate yourselves about this. Because when I did this 6 years ago, it was bad enough. But it's got worse. And so to focus on this at the beginning, I hope, means that it's a happy outcome for people who want the comfort of a pet dog, but also will deal with online sales where you don't know where the pets are coming from or the state they're in.
OK, thank you. Kate Forbes.
Thanks very much. I wanted to unpack a little bit around why your legislation is needed compared with what we have already, and I think you've answered that quite comprehensively. But why do you think the Scottish Government hasn't, even though it's different from what you're proposing, why has the Scottish Government not updated or revisited the code since 2010? Is that indicative of the lack of concern by the Scottish Government? Is it indicative of the fact that they feel updating it wouldn't necessarily solve the problem anyway? Well, I know it's for the Minister.
It really is for the Minister.
But you must have considered whether that might have been a route for achieving the purposes you want to achieve.
It's more than that, Ms Forbes. It's a case of a simple focus thing. I've already addressed in my opening statement, if this were to be absorbed into the general codes, to me it gets lost in translation. What I wanted was to focus on purchasing and acquiring of puppies in an uninformed fashion, which was also ancillary to an increase in the puppy factory farms. Not the only thing, but it was part of it. And I think by making that simple code, you're dealing with a different cohort of people. You're dealing with people who are, for good reason, you know, want the company of a pet, they see it, it's so on. You're making them focus on that. And I hope that if this proceeds by doing that code, you then change the nature of, if I may call it loosely, the unlicensed puppy trade.
So I suppose we're conscious that, you know, that is a logical conclusion, that if something stands alone on its own merit, it inevitably is going to be clearer and more accessible. But there is a lot of legislation in and around animal welfare and so on, which becomes quite a littered landscape.
Cluttered.
A cluttered landscape. Does that have its own challenges, though, for anybody coming into contact with this issue, is to know how is best to prosecute, what guidance is actually relevant to them, and where do they even start?
I think I would clutter even more cluttered if this were to be absorbed into existing. Mm. I'm decluttering it. Okay. What is the big issue? What's the biggest problem that starts out when you have the looking after a dog as a pet? It starts from the moment you get it. If you get the wrong pet, the wrong circumstances, for the wrong reasons, haven't seen it with its mother, you've got problems from the start. So dealing with the welfare issues, once you have a pet, you should really be dealing with it in advance of that. Mm. And on top of that, this legislation would require you to have almost self-certification with the person transferring you. They've got a job here to do as well. They've got to say they think you're the right person. A licensed breeder will do that. A good licensed breeder will check you out. Won't let any Tom, Dick or Harry. That's not PC now to say Tom, Dick and Harry. But anyway, Tom, Dick S and Harry. They will check you out. They'll check your circumstances. Rehoming centres like the SSPCA do that. You can't just go in and get a cat or a dog. They'll check out your circumstances. And they won't let you have one. You're the wrong person. So this is a level of which a person transferring to you who's not licensed will do that. And you too will be in conversation. And you will, importantly, so far as is humanly practicable, see that puppy with its siblings, with the mother. That tells you an awful lot about how that has been brought up. And the certificate will say, I've thought about all that. Maybe people don't always get it right, but it will mean they pause and do it. I'm sure that everyone sitting around this table, if they were thinking of getting a puppy, would do that. But that's not the case for many people, for very good reason. And they get, you know, COVID highlighted that. And that's just to make sure that they do what everybody around here, I think, would do.
Thanks. And one very short one. Oh, sorry, Ross, can you go to come in? Apologies.
Just briefly on the specifics of the point you made about how existing legislation would sit alongside this bill. And it's just to mention in relation to criminal liability.
Oh, yes.
So deliberately, the bill is drafted in a way that it lifts sections from existing, the 2006 existing Act. So failure to comply with requirements of the code or the certificate can be taken as supporting evidence if other animal welfare offences have been committed. And that also complements the 2021 regulations. So I can provide the committee with a list of the ways in which those pieces of legislation fit together in terms of how the SSPCA would actively potentially pursue something.
Yeah, it's actually in the policy memorandum at page 7, the current law and practice and how enforcement would be taking. That's why it's not necessary to put it into this particular piece of legislation.
I suppose that's our core question, convener, is whether the very laudable aims are best served through alternative legislation or changes to the current legislation. I think you've answered that helpfully. I've got one last small point, which is that you've made the point that what is distinct about this is that you are reaching prospective keepers and owners rather than existing, which is a notoriously difficult group to reach because by its very nature, prospective is not necessarily easy to identify and really does boil down to somebody's foresight in looking at what they might have to engage with. How do you envisage raising awareness of this so that prospective keepers know that they will now be caught by new legislation?
Well, first of all, the major onus is on suppliers. I mean, they're in the business. Many of them, some may not, but most of them are. So the big onus is on suppliers. But also in terms of the code, there is a duty upon the Scottish Government to publicise this. And there's also the issue of the certificate, which I think is, you know, it takes a whole change in the way of engagement. Very rarely do we say to people, if you've read a code, if you've read the legislation, you've got to sign something saying you've read and understood it. I think the engagement is saying you're part of this. And part of the issue I want the public to understand is you are the custodians and you're policing the welfare of the Scotland's puppies and young dogs that come into the system, to come into. They're the people who will do it. That's why I go back to its demand that will change the nature of supply. And informed demand, it's a horrible expression, demand, but informed demand will mean that the puppies that come through, in my expectation, will change. Because people will say, wait a minute, I've seen this puppy online. I know I can't. I'm not supposed to do this. Mm. Don't know who this person is. Or you see there's somebody at a market that's got some puppies in the van. And the trouble is people think they're rescuing.
Yeah.
They think they're rescuing the animals. And all that's happening is these are products for sale. They're not rescuing. Because if you see your puppy in a distressed state and it's a little bigger, and I'll take it, all that happens is in the conveyor belt of these factory farms, some bitch is being put through the system to produce more puppies.
Mm.
And so by doing that, you become part of regulating and being a part of the system. And I think it's good for owners. I get quite emotional about this because I can't have a dog because of my lifestyle. I've gone through those tests myself and said, I can't do this. And because I've got the cat and because I'm not there and all these things, and my age, you have to take that into account. So you have to do this and say to yourself, I'll be hard. There are other ways of enjoying the company of a dog if you must. You can foster, you can go in the pet shelter and take them for walks. But maybe it's not right for you to have that. And really, what distresses me is I've had 6 years of doing this. And in that time, it's got worse in the system. If it hadn't got worse, I'd have packed it in. You know, I don't need to be arguing this. I could leave it to the government, you know. I'd have packed it in. But the point is it hasn't. And so I think by doing this legislation, pushing the government to put a code through, pushing them to do it, we move the dial, to use that horrible expression.
Thank you.
I've got Rachel with a brief supplementary before I bring in Alistair Allen.
Morning, Ms. Graham. You've just said that, you know, you've been working on this for 6 years. Would you be disappointed, because obviously things have changed in those 6 years, and we know that the code of practice has actually is probably outdated now and it's got shortcomings. Would you be disappointed if the government combined the two?
I was going to say tear my hair out, but it looks as if I've done that already to some of it. I would be disappointed. This isn't an ego trip. I'd be disappointed because I don't think it would work as this would work. That's my key. I care about Christine Graham's legislation. I care about effectiveness of a code of practice in changing the way people behave in acquiring a puppy or a dog. And if I thought that in the next year the amending existing codes would be effective, I'd say, but I don't think so. I don't think so at all, because this is simple. The questions are really simple. You can see that for yourself. They're straightforward questions that anybody can understand. It's not complex. The existing code's 28 pages with all these links. Who's going to read that? This is straightforward. A wee checklist. And I see that Thompson's wanting to come in there. Just looking after me.
Very briefly, that on page 12 of the policy memorandum is a sample of what the certificate could look like. It could be in plainer English, I imagine, but effectively that's the entire contents of the code on two sides of A4. The key questions: how old's the puppy? Have you met the mum? Are you familiar with whether or not there's a breeder's license? Have you taken all reasonable steps to establish that? So it's two sides. That's the core contents of the code, just to give you a sense of how distinct that would be from the longer code that the member mentions.
OK. I know we're moving on from this subject, but I just want to make the point that in the evidence, it has been suggested that it's confusing and it's burdensome to have the two, which really speaks to the previous question.
A question, unless you come back in.
That's the point. The government hasn't committed to amending the current code. But I also would riposte that by saying I dispute that, in that this is so simple that I could go out tomorrow with that list and say to people in Tesco's, that little list of things that you should check out, and I think they would understand it. But if I went out with a full amended code, I think they would go, for goodness sake, 40 pages, I'm not reading that.
Okay. It leads us on nicely to a question from Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Ms Graham. I wonder if you could say a wee bit about the code of practice and why you chose it to put it on the face of the bill rather than some other mechanism, perhaps, that might have given ministers the power to regulate in that area.
Right, here we go. Now, to me, these are, as I've said, these are the fundamental questions to ask when you're buying a dog. They're not, it's not complete. It's open to the government within the ambit of these questions if they wish to have additional questions. But these are the very straightforward ones. And I put them there to ensure that these would go on to any code as a direction to the government. Too much legislation is complex. When you're asking the public to operate in legislation, it's different if you're asking lawyers. Asking the public, it has to be easily understood. And I think the list that I have put in the face of the bill, which I want in the code, are easily understood. Not complicated for people. But they're important that they are followed. So why I've said that, there's scope for other information of the government, but not to go beyond that kind of ambit. But the code is constructed, they're absolutely vital. If you look through the questions that I've got in the bill, which I will now dig out, you look at them, there's nothing. This is straightforward English. Is the breed suitable? It's an important question. Is the breed suitable for you and your family? Is the environment suitable? Should have you six floors up and going to get a great big dog that needs a lot of exercise? Not a good idea. Lift might break. You know, these things are simple things. Would the dog fit in with the composition of the households? You got a baby on the way. Is this a good time to get a dog? You know, you've got a lot of young children. What breed should you have? Are the costs associated with keeping the dog? Food, bed. Now, I said in my opening statement, very few people think you don't. It's an emotional thing. So they don't consider the costs that lie ahead. Believe you me, when you walk into the vets, you've either got to have insurance for the dog or get a big pocket of money in it because it's expensive. Are you committed to caring the dogs? And that puppy that starts out as a toddler, as it were, in your house, becomes a naughty adolescent, tearing things to bits, you're going to have it for 10, 15 years. Your life will move on. Are you ready for you to take that dog and move on with it? You know. So these are not complicated questions. But I think they're the kind of questions, because this is to educate the public, that the public will understand. Okay. And they won't be offended by them.
Okay,
you've got to have the public on your side.
Thank you. I suppose my question is also about, and this is something that we kind of wrestle with, and as you'll be more than familiar with, in legislation in general, about how much of a code of conduct appears on the face of a bill and how much is left to secondary legislation or action by ministers. So I just wondered if you'd considered that balance when you were, how you decided on what should appear on the face of the bill in the code.
Well, I decided, after consultation, obviously, with the various organisations and that support it, that these are the sort of basic questions. I think once you've gone to those basic questions, there may be for another person another question they might ask. For example, they might have a medical condition that will deteriorate their ability over time. That would be a different question for them. But the basic ones, which are not often considered by people, are the ones that you need to start with. Simply, where am I living? Is this the right place? You know, what's my family like? Do you have cats? Do you have another dog? What's this, that? All that kind of... Some people, in fact, actually may even ask the vet before they get a pet. So that you don't need to put that in. But that's part of the consideration of things. So I thought these were just good starters for 10, as it were.
And finally, Convener, you mentioned that you couldn't have a list that was 40 pages long, and I appreciate that. But I just wonder, were there other things that you considered and decided not to put in there on that list? I mean, what one of the issues that I'm sure you probably did consider was the issue of microchipping, for instance.
Because I wanted to keep it short, punchy, easily understood. If you're going to educate, don't blur it up. Don't put too much in for people. Perhaps as a former secondary teacher, I realise you can only teach so much in one lesson. So to me, these were key. And as I said to you previously, there may be additional questions that somebody else is asking themselves. But these are the basics. And that it's open to the government, as I say, in that section, subject to being within the ambit of what I already have, to add any other ones that they may consider. But that is within the ambit of what's there.
Thank you.
Can I just follow on from that? So have you given any consideration to regulation-making powers to amend the content of that through sub-ledge?
Sorry, don't quite follow that.
So have you considered how in this bill you could ensure that the regulations were in place to allow amendment through centre legislation?
Are you referring to my letter to the Legislative Committee, DPLR?
And if you were going to revise that list, so for example, if you're successful and get through the microchipping section, surely you'd want to have microchipping in one of the 10 or whatever notes.
Yes.
Or if more information comes forward that Battersea or SSPCA thinks important to be on the face of the bill, have you given any consideration how that would happen?
Well, first of all, it could happen at stage two if within the ambit of the bill someone wanted to add something at stage two. But then also in doing the code, the time the code goes through, and I've got my letter to DPLR when I'm quite content that it goes through parliamentary scrutiny, there's an opportunity to there. But within the ambit of the purpose of the bill, educating and so on, and not extending beyond its purposes, as it were. But yes, this is, as at stage one, it's a starting point, laying the groundwork.
But I guess that you've omitted to put anything in there about microchipping, which... It's going to be quite important. So we passed this bill with what's there currently. I suppose what I'm asking is, shouldn't there be some route to amend that? Because the government are even saying that there's some tweaks that will be required. Now, they could bring them through at secondary legislation, but we might have a new minister who gets advice, and after we pass this potentially at stage three, the ability to amend it is then gone, unless you put something in there that allows it to be updated through secondary legislation.
Well, first of all, the government has not undertaken anything about microchipping. I seem to recall, Convener, you may have been in the Audit Committee in 2016, I may be wrong. You weren't.
No.
I'm maligning you. I raised this in 2016 about a national microchipping database, and there was a sort of vague undertaking that they were looking at, and nothing has happened in all that time. I would love for there to be a national microchipping database. I think that would solve an awful lot. But it would be open. I've passed to Ross here, or Thompson, but I think, in my view, it would be open for the government to amend that in if they would wanted to. But they've not shown any indication since 2016 to do so.
But this is your bill, so why don't you have microchipping in the face
because
of
I started with Because I started, Convener, with registration, and microchipping was nowhere on the horizon. Nothing had happened since the microchipping legislation came in. So I started with registration. Now, if registration is cumbersome, as the government claims, and they are now discussing, and we're now pushing microchipping, I'm happy. Either way, we have a database, because every puppy 8 weeks and over has to be microchipped. We have a national database of dogs, which is a beginning. A lot of information's in that microchip. So that's fine by me. I mean, if registration is cumbersome and we're walking down the road to microchipping national database, grand. That's part of why, in a way, part two, though I wanted registration, has served an important purpose, a national database. Ross, do you want to say anything?
Just very briefly, the key elements on the face of the bill are the things that the member considers absolutely must be in the code, and then they can absolutely be added to, including suggestions from the bodies that you've taken written evidence from. And then, as the member confirmed, that would then be subject to consultation and parliamentary scrutiny.
But the code is for the code is at the time of transfer of the dog. Microchipping is part two of this, is where we move to part two about a registration system. Yeah, so it wouldn't be in the code.
Yeah, I guess I'm just. It seems strange that there's no ability to add or remove what is in the you've got in the face of the bill.
It says in section 5, revision of code. The Scottish Ministers may revise the code of practice as it is effect for the time being.
But
so they can revise.
Yes, absolutely, in the code. But on the face of your bill, there's no ability to change your key points. Once the bill is passed, there is nothing in the legislation to allow that to be amended.
There's stage two amendments. What I have done on that bill is, after long consultation, trying to keep it as uncluttered as possible for the prime purpose of second thoughts, third thoughts by somebody acquiring a puppy. I think it delivers that. Other matters may then come in. You've raised microchipping. Delighted you have. But I think that is really where we'll look at part two, where I was looking for registration to assist people acquiring and suppliers. And if that can be done, perhaps not immediately, but if we have a national microchipping database to which we can add information, because at the moment there's many companies, as you know, and they're not, and you move from one place to another, nobody knows, then that's great. And if this moves that forward, then I'm content, subject to what the government has to say about microchipping, that part two goes.
Okay. Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to you all.
Oh, I was dizzy there. I was like, I'm with you now.
I know how hard you've worked on this for the last six years because I have been very interested in following the process, because I've been interested about illegal puppy farming and illegal puppy trafficking, and how do we reduce that and prevent that, because we know dogs are still coming through the port of Cairn Ryan, or puppies, I should say. So I'm interested, Ms Graham, in 2021, the regulations established licensing conditions for the sale of puppies under 6 months, such as requiring the puppy to be seen with its mother. So that is an important part of, I suppose, mitigating trafficking to see a puppy with its mother. But I'm interested to know that the bill has chosen to define a young dog as a dog under 12 months, but I think the SSPCA define a puppy as less than 6 months. Can you tell us a little bit about why the bill has chosen to define a young dog as a dog under 12 months for the purpose of the additional requirements in Section 3?
Well, there's the first transfer, which would be the puppy stage. There's a first transfer. So if you look at the bill, if you look at the sections of the bill, you look at Section 2, sale or transfer of any dog. That's in a way to deal with if somebody were to acquire a puppy at that the puppy stage from the breeder, unlicensed, I hasten to add, not talking about licensed, unlicensed breeder, then they have to go through this and do the certificate. But they may then move on to someone else. And that means they go through the process again, which is the sale of transfer of Section 3 of any dog by the first owner. In a way, part of the thinking behind this was that you might have someone who would acquire from an unlicensed breeder, say, I've done it, and then they move on to somebody else. And that way, it's caught under Section 3 because they've still got to go through a list of questions, they've still got to complete a certificate. So it was kind of catching that bit from puppy to 12 months. That's what that was about. So if you just did it for puppies, you've got a kind of a loophole already there. And that's what that was looking at.
So if I bring six dogs over on the ferry, and there are six puppies over on the ferry, and move them to sell them for $2,500 each because they're bonny wee spaniels, mm-hmm. And then somebody says, right, I want to move this dog on because they don't, that person keeps the six puppies. So this would cover moving those dogs on to another yeah. person who was going to receive
yeah. the dogs. I'll ask Claudia to do the legalities, but that's my view.
Section 3 relates to the sale from the first owner of the litter of puppies, but these general questions that the public is supposed to ask themselves before getting a puppy still apply.
Yeah. Okay. So it's that transfer. It's not just the first purchase, but you could be supplier to acquirer. Acquirer has them for a short time. Acquirer to somebody else. That's what that's going for.
So again, this would help promote reduce unregistered transfer of dogs, but again, promoting education for yes. whoever's going to be the recipient yes. of the young dog or the puppy.
Yes.
Okay, thanks.
A question from Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, and thanks, Christine, for coming in and giving us your evidence on your bill. And certainly I align my thoughts with Emma Harper in terms of the amount of work you've put into it to get this far. Continuing on, the word loopholes came up in the last question, and so continuing there, the bill provides that young dogs are to be seen with the mother, so this is about the wording, unless this is not practicable.
Yeah.
And there was a couple of stakeholders that raised concerns about that being a loophole and were asking for something a bit more specific. So I wondered what you thought about that. So, for example, Battersea Dog and Cats Homes have suggested unless this is not practicable for welfare reasons, and the Dogs Trust suggested an example of if the mum is deceased. So I just wonder what your thoughts are.
Yes, that could be the case, but that's more unlikely. But it might be that the person acquiring physically, just physically, is unable and sends someone in their place to do it. So that is understandable. If somebody is highly disabled or whatever, then somebody else can go for them and check it out. But the vast majority, will be that the person should be seeing the puppy with the siblings and the mother, unless there are circumstances. I hesitate the word exceptional, but close to that, you know, in the main it must be that.
But what do you think about the suggestions that the person going to see the puppy has to see that with the mother, unless it's not practical, is what you've got in the bill, but the suggestion is that that needs to be clearer and that alternative suggestions are not practical for welfare reasons, so we're really specific about why it's not.
Thank you. I've located it.
Great.
There may be circumstances where a puppy can't see his mother, and I allow for these. And there's section 2021 regulations which set out the number of circumstances. So we've got a puppy may only be shown to a prospective fit together with its biological mother. Now, the difference is it doesn't apply if the separation of the puppy from its biological mother is necessary for the health or welfare of the puppy or other puppies from the same litter or the puppies, which you refer to, the puppy's biological mother is deceased. I mean, we can see the reasons when it wouldn't be practicable. Yes. But that's already there in regulations.
It is there.
But Okay. Most of this is common sense. Most of this is common sense to people. You know, they should be asking the person supplying, well, why can't I see the puppy with its mother? And challenging.
But in a way, part of why you're bringing forward this whole bill is partly because you would think some of this is common sense, but actually what you've discovered is that it isn't.
It's because, and it has increased during COVID, is that we've got so used to things online. You get messages online, you get your shoes online, some people get their car online, and now it's quite common, relatively common for people to buy animals online, puppies online. The difference is the puppy's a sentient being. The car can fall apart and it's your fault, but the puppy, you have a responsibility to the welfare of that animal from the moment it is bred to the moment you acquire it. So that's really what it's getting at. Our culture has changed. But we must reverse that when we're dealing with sentient beings such as animals.
Small supplementary, Jim Fairley.
Thanks, Convener, and thank you, Ms Graham, for coming to the committee. It's just a curiosity on my part. Where did the 6 months come from? Because anyone who's selling a pup, by and large, will sell it between 8 and 12 weeks. Is there a definition somewhere that I've missed that allows it to be 6 months? Because usually most pups will be sold long before they ever get to the six-month stage. And I just, that gap, I find that quite surprising.
Well, I'm going to call Claudia, but I think I made it clear. Some people are acquiring directly from the unlicensed breeder, but I thought I was dealing with what might be a loophole, might not be always a loophole, but somebody might acquire a puppy from an unlicensed breeder, keep it for a bit, maybe they can't cope with it, or maybe they've got other motives, and they then transfer it to somebody else. That's why I've got the 12-month deadline sort of thing for it, so that you've still got those obligations. You've still got those obligations. Most people acquiring online, I don't want to just focus online, but let's say online will be puppies, cute little puppies. But there will be other dogs as well that they're acquiring that are maybe 6 months old, 7 months old. And they've already been with somebody, maybe not with the unlicensed breeder, but with somebody else. The same obligations are there, so that's why I took it up to 12 months. Okay. Different rules from first unlicensed breeders, you can see in the bill, to those that are dogs up to 12 months.
Okay.
Claudia, do you want to?
Just to add that the intention originally was that the register, which is where this 12-month requirement comes from, was supposed to be a temporary register. So the first owner of the litter of puppies only has to register once that person intends to sell or transfer the puppy. So, you know, the owner might originally intend to keep the puppy and keep it for a few months, and then realize it's too much. Yes. And then once the intention to sell or transfer is there, only then does the registration requirement arise. And the code was supposed to work, or the intention is that the code and the register work hand in hand, and that's why this 12 months time limit was adopted for you know, for the part of the code as well.
Rachel, have you got very small, because I'm just conscious of time on this?
Yeah, just on that point, if somebody went to a welfare home, dog and cat home, and there was a sheepdog puppy that somebody had said that they couldn't cope with, how does your bill support an individual who wants to rehome that puppy, but that puppy has very difficult behavioural issues or needs specific conditions or requirements?
I have to say, it's a good question, Ms Hamilton, but they're very strict. The rehoming centre, SSP and Dogs Trust, are very strict. If they've got a dog with behavioural issues, cutesy though it may be, and somebody says, "Oh, I just love it," they would say this dog has issues. And quite often they keep them and retrain them. I mean, they are, in fact, huge custodians of the welfare of the animals they have and of the people that want them, and they simply will not do it. I know that from experience, because I'm a member of the SSPCA, which I probably should have declared. I'm also a patron of the Edinburgh Dog and Cat Home, and I know they won't do it. They've had some dogs there for a couple of years because they haven't got the right match for that dog.
Thank you. Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, panel. I turn now to the issue of the certificates for ownership. We had the round table in September, and animal welfare stakeholders generally expressed support for the certificates. But Battersea Dogs and Homes, Dogs and Cats Home raised the issue of enforcing the certificates. And you've already said that the certificates are mandatory, but whose responsibility would it be to ensure that a certificate is actually completed?
Well, it's the responsibility of the, if I call them the transferor and the transferee, the person who's the dog that's transferring over to somebody else who's acquiring it, it's their responsibility for there to be a certificate. But the certificate is to be produced, you don't have to have it all the time, but if there's an issue arising, then an animal welfare organisation such as the SSPCA that might receive a call concerned for the welfare of a dog in a household can ask, post this, if this goes through, to see the certificate. And, of course, today, everything can be online. You can print things out, or you can get them at libraries and print things. So, you know, you can actually demonstrate, well, yes, I did do that. If you haven't done the certificate, you're supposed to do it. But there are circumstances. This, again, is an educational thing. It's not punitive. So there may be circumstances in which the person has not done it. And there's a within the legislation, there's scope within the legislation here and in the criminal legislation under the Animal Welfare 2006 Act for circumstances where there's an allowance for it, you know, where somebody hasn't done something. But it's not been malign, it's been negligent in a sense, but not so negligent that they deserve to have any penalty for it. So there's in all legislation, there should always, in my view, except in road traffic acts and so on, when it's absolute, is there's a flexibility for certain circumstances. But you would have to show why you didn't know about it. But again, the certificate is really, it's to make people aware and know that they've read and done this. It's a physical demonstration that they've known and done it. I think most people, frankly, because it's not onerous, will be pleased to do it. Say, well, I'm happy to do that. You know, that was a good idea.
But it comes back to people who are responsible. People who are responsible will do it anyway, and obviously you're trying to reach those, the irresponsible.
I wouldn't call them irresponsible, you know. I wouldn't call them that, because it's a terribly emotional thing. I don't know many people here got a dog or a puppy emotionally. And you know, the head came in somewhere down the road. So I wouldn't call them irresponsible. It's just that it's very hard. Think of COVID and people stuck at home over 2 years and how they needed companionship. I wouldn't call it irresponsible. What I'm just saying is you may wish to proceed, but just think what suits you at this time. And it may very well be at the end of the day, it's quite right that they get a dog for companionship, a puppy for companionship. But it's having considered everything else, maybe getting the right dog at the right time. So I would be careful about, you know, saying they're irresponsible. I just think that they need to think. It's tough to say, no, I'm in the wrong place to have a puppy. It's tough to say that to yourself. You desperately want it, but it may be the right thing for you at that time even, and for the puppy. But importantly, it is also, if you're going to do it, having considered everything, you get it from the right place. You know, so it's not just the right reason, the right place.
Thank you.
So, just a very short answer.
Do I need a tin hat?
If you could. No, no. So, it's the responsibility of the seller to ensure that the acquirer has filled in the certificate, which says that they've read all the requirements, if you like, and then the acquirer and the seller must sign that certificate. So it's really the responsibility of the seller to ensure that the buyer has undertaken the checklist.
Let's just flip that a little. Suppliers in the main will be more aware, but both must sign the certificate. Both must be aware of the responsibilities under the certificate.
Yeah. So the legislation
just bear
would
with
suggest.
Me. I think I'm being supported. Claudia.
The main emphasis is on the acquirer, and the acquirer, for example, has to complete the certificate and print it out. The responsibility is on the supplier is to check
that it's
taken place. And the acquirer must challenge the supplier. I think that's the point. Challenge is perhaps too strong a word, but must question. We're back to the purpose, if I go back to this. The purpose, again, is to stop casual, emotional acquiring of puppies, which is not in the interests of the puppies, and it's not in the interests of the people who are acquiring them, and it's to make them pause. And that the code separated off is so simple and straightforward because it's to educate that section of the public, quite likely referred to, not others, but that just don't think long and hard enough. And it might be in a year's time it would be the right thing for them, but it's not the right thing for that time. So that's what this is about.
Okay, thank you. Again, as briefly as possible, just conscious of time, how does the code and certificate apply to buyers resident in Scotland who wish to purchase a puppy somewhere else in the UK or from abroad?
No. If they're resident in Scotland, it applies, but I can't legislate, no government can legislate beyond the jurisdiction of Scotland. But one of the questions you would be asking, if it was coming in from puppies imported from abroad, whether it's from Ireland or from Romania or wherever, you're not seeing it with its mother. You know, the point is, you've got to see that puppy with its mother. In most circumstances, you can't see it.
But
you should be seeing where's this puppy coming from.
It doesn't matter whether it's abroad or anywhere else, does it?
Because
you can't compel anybody out with Scotland to basically apply the certificate rules at all.
No, but the point is the acquirer will be seeing, here's this puppy for sale. I can't get to see it. Where's it coming from? They've checked. It's coming across the boat to Stranraer from Southern Ireland from a puppy factory farm. It's coming from Romania, where they're pretending it's a rescue puppy, which it's not. It's been bred to come to this country and say, why can't I see this dog? I can't see this puppy with its mother. Ah, wait a minute, something fishy going on here. And that would stop them from doing it. This is the point. You can't legislate for the supplier out with the jurisdiction, but you're legislating for the acquirer, the demand purpose. That was what it was all basically stimulated, this bill.
Okay, so the prospective acquirer, someone buying the puppy, would still need to fill in a certificate, even though there was no obligation for the seller to do so.
They couldn't fill it in because they wouldn't have checked. Yeah. They wouldn't have been able to see the puppy. You have seen the puppy with its mother, daddy. None of that would have been there because that was the point. I mean, many people think they're rescuing dogs when, in fact, it's a business.
Okay.
A European business as well as a business from Southern Ireland in the main.
Jim Fairley. Oh, sorry. Ros, did you want to come in? No. Jim.
No.
Just a brief observation on that point. Doesn't that kind of... When people are going to rescue a puppy, they're doing it because they're rescuing the puppy. Doesn't that kind of negate the point that you've made, because that emotional pull to rescue that puppy will still be there, regardless of whether they can see the mother or not, on the basis that they've been shown a picture, and whoever it is that's selling that story, saying, these pups, we found them abandoned, we need good homes for them, the emotional tug's going to be there. So that part of it is going to be...
That's what I've got to overcome.
Yeah.
But that's a good question, because that's what... Because you're not rescuing...
They're not rescuing...
No, you're not rescuing. You're buying a product that criminals are breeding. You take that puppy, and there'll be another six in its place, so $2,500 to $3,000 each.
Doesn't that just come back to the whole point that this is as much about education of the population in general, rather than putting provisions in place to try and force the issue?
I'm not forcing.
To bring in this legislation to add another thing that they have to do.
Well, the point is, what we have isn't working. And this code being... Everybody knows about... Well, not everybody, but it's quite common to know about puppy factory farms now. There's, you know, even today, the fact that puppies are being sent back to and abandoned and so on, dogs are being abandoned and so on, tells us that we're not having the problem. So I'll just conclude on this for Mr. Fairley. The code is simple. The code is to educate. The code is to let people realise you're not rescuing. You are creating more misery for more puppies.
Okay, thank you.
I'm going to move to Alistair Allen again. It moves on nicely.
Yep, I'll be brief. Thank you, Convener. You spoke earlier on, Ms. Graham, we all did, a fair bit about common sense and the common sense that should apply and often doesn't. So the Minister and some stakeholders have suggested that, that already public awareness of existing codes of practice might be low. Do you feel that the bill, what do you feel in the bill could improve public awareness around what's expected of people when they buy a puppy?
Yeah, well, first of all, there's a requirement to publicise, which governments don't always do with members' bills, I have to add, although they've said they might in previous times and didn't do it, but also repeat publicity. And you'll see that in the financial memorandum, which mentions the cost of a publicity campaign and reinvigorating it. And to me, that underlines why the simplicity of this code makes it understandable. Because it says to people, here are some things you have to consider, here's your awareness. And I would hope that if the government goes for this, and actually we do have public awareness campaigns, it would start with the images of what happens if you don't apply these tests. The puppies that have behavioural issues, that are crammed in crates with lots of different breeds, that are unscrupulously sold for a fortune, that you're not rescuing, test these things. Help us. Help the various welfare organisations and local authorities and everybody else who gets involved in this to prevent wrongful breeding of puppies.
Thank you.
One of the driving factors behind this is public awareness and education. And that's the overriding reason for this bill, really. Your costs suggest that raising public awareness in the year that comes, the bill comes into force, is between 200,000 and 250,000, then 5 years thereafter, which are based on the government's figures. But the government says and acknowledges that public awareness of the existing code is likely to be low. So how can you improve public awareness when you're not intending to have a bigger budget than the government currently has?
To my knowledge, the government was content with the costs. And these are the gross costs, the costs of public awareness. But when you offset that, which is difficult to quantify as net costs, that's the costs not just to the public purse, but to welfare organisations and everything else with coping with the fallout from animals that are abandoned and that are in a state of distress, or animals that have behavioural issues. And,
yeah, but sorry,
know, so
I'm going to interrupt you.
Sorry?
The point is, you're not projecting to spend any more than the government does currently, and the government has said that, and acknowledged, the public awareness of the existing code is likely to be low. which suggests they're not spending enough money on it. So you're not going to spend any more money on a public awareness campaign. So why would the outcomes be any better?
Well, first of all, I'm hopeful that the certificate itself, in the initial stages, if this goes through, the certificate itself will reduce the necessity to publicise and to run public awareness campaigns about the illegal puppy trade and doing all that. So I hope the certificate, because that's the point of it, education, change public behaviour, let the public do the job of what I think we all want. We want to end the illegal puppy trade and the distress that happens and the wrong puppies for the wrong reasons. So we all want that. So I'm hoping the certificate will do that. In terms of publicity campaigns, they're already running them about different ones about don't bite this, and they're not working. They're not working because it's getting worse. More people are buying online, more people are abandoning them and so on. So by having this particular campaign on acquisition, and this is going back to the key thing, the problems start when you first get the puppy. There's a problem start there. So I'm hoping that if we start there, we decrease the requirement for subsequent things, saying, you know, a puppy is for life, not for Christmas, okay. The very famous one.
OK, thank you. That's a useful answer. Jim Fairley.
Thanks, Convener. We have rehearsed this conversation in private,
I don't remember it, Celia.
I think it's crucial we get it on the record that there are stakeholders and ministers have indicated that they feel the scope with part one of the bill should extend to all dogs and not just pets. So, can you explain why you chose to limit the scope to pet dogs, and whether you would be open to extending the scope?
Well, you've heard my thrust, which was about people buying online and buying with their emotions. That's what it was about. My experience, and I'm sure yours is from your background, is people who are acquiring working dogs, they're working. That's the key. They know their pedigree, they know their attributes, they know where they're coming from in the main. They're not buying casually. That dog's got to earn its keep. Mm-hmm. So it's a very different kettle of fish. I think working dogs, think about police dogs, assistance dogs, guide dogs, gamekeepers' dogs. They're all trained, they all have certain, and actually in their breeding they have certain attributes. It was never aimed at that, and I don't see the point, because that's not the gamekeepers, the people who train the guide dogs. They know what they're looking for. They are educated. They can say, well, I'm not getting that. I know this collie would be very good. I know it's parents, parenthood and all that. So it's a very different thing. That's why it's not that. This was aimed at pets, not working dogs. And I don't think it should include working dogs.
OK. I see a slight problem with this. In that if you don't broaden the definition to all dogs, there will be farmers like myself who have sold pups in the past to pet homes.
Yes.
So how do you define when it's a pet and when it's a working dog?
Well, first of all, I know that situation because my own dog, my Irish setter, came from a gamekeeper at Twynham. And he kept two, and the rest were sold as pets. Yep. So I understand the circumstances. Well, let's look at the definition of a pet. Under the government's 2021 licensing, it says, first, a pet means an animal kept permanently or intended to be kept permanently by a person, mainly for personal interest, companionship, I don't know what about this one, ornamental purposes, whatever that is, and any combination of A to C. Now, a working dog, we can have a litter and the pet, one is a pet. Then that becomes, and that comes into the legislation. You know, you're now transferring. That's where we get to the 12-month thing, because you might take a few months to decide this dog's not got the, pup's not got the attributes to work on my farm. And therefore, you then become a transferee in somebody, so you come under the legislation. But that's an obvious one. To me, that's obvious, and it's commonplace. Because any gamekeeper's dog, or if you take guide dogs, I mean, I've sponsored three pups, and only, I think it must be to do with me sponsoring, but only two have succeeded in becoming guide dogs. The other two have become pets. so they come under this legislation. Do you want to say something else?
Just very briefly, that in circumstances where the owner of the litter has working dogs and is then selling to somebody who is acquiring for the purpose of it being a pet, the responsibility is on the acquirer in relation to the terms of the code and the certificate.
Okay.
And in that circumstance, can I also say, Mr. Fairley, I saw my puppy with the other dogs, very well socialised, happy as a bunny kind of thing. So I actually saw, and the gamekeeper told us, you know, I'm keeping these two and these other six. I don't need them, and they're suitable. So it's you know, to me, it's not a difficult one. And the difference, too, from a working dog is a working dog retires. A pet doesn't retire. A working dog may retire and be kept with a person then after that.
Okay, thank you. We're going to move on to part two, the register of unlicensed litters, and a question from Kate Forbes.
Thank you very much. I suppose just a broad question on this section to start with, because obviously the Minister was permitted the opportunity to speak about this, and I was just keen to hear your perspective on the various points that have been made by stakeholders and the Minister on your rationale for proposing a registration system for unlicensed litters and how you see it working in practice.
Well, the bill, of course, we've got licensed, and set that aside, this is unlicensed. It means any advert for any puppy or young dog would need to include a registration number for the dog from a breeder or a dog from unlicensed breeder. I envisage this would provide reassurance that someone acquiring a dog would know the owner is compliant with other regimes relating to selling of puppies. Again, this would require the public to be aware of the new system where every advert has a number for one or two regimes. The bill provides for awareness raising, and I would envisage this would need to happen on an ongoing, you know, a rolling register, not just a one-off basis. The creation of registration requirement would mean all puppies and young dogs sold in Scotland would be traceable, which would assist local authorities and the SSP and other welfare organisations in relation to enforcement. Because sometimes it's difficult to know, you know, a dog misbehaves, there's no owner to be seen in sight. Whose dog is it? So we would have that. At present, there is, if someone is not a licensed breeder, it is assumed they are breeding fewer than three litters. There's no simple way to establish if they're breeding on a wider scale in an unlicensed way. In other words, they're breeding lots, but they've not applied for a license. Traceability of any puppy would aid enforcement to prevent wide-scale sale of puppies from multiple litters by those in the illegal puppy farm trade. The register would also inform decision makers of for those purchasing dogs, and could highlighting where a seller is not compliant with either regime. So there are the purposes of registration, really traceability.
Thank you. Just wanted to get that on the record.
Okay. Can we move on to a question from Alistair Allen?
Thank you. I take it we're still in the realms of... Question 11. I didn't want to give the game away by giving a number.
What, how many have you got? That would be nice to know in advance.
Okay, in that case, can I ask what your view is on concerns that the Minister raised, that a registration scheme could actually provide false assurance to some potential buyers? Is that a view that you would refute or that you would share? Or?
Well, I noticed the Minister suggested it was not workable, not a proportionate response, may not improve animal welfare, could provide unwarranted assurance to buyers, could provide a front for those selling puppies in legal puppy trade. And it, apart from the fact that the government intends to amend the bill to take out that part, should it proceed to stage two. It would be, to me, we'd be doing a disservice to stakeholders I work with who supported the provisions for registration and the benefits they believe a register of unlicensed litters would bring if I didn't continue to highlight the benefits of implementing Part 2, notwithstanding the position of the government. What I would say, and I've said this, is should the committee or members of the committee be considering that we'd support the general principles if Part 2 is removed, I would strongly encourage members of this committee to consider the clear need for traceability of puppies by some means, and to seek an assurance from the government in stage two report that progress be made in this regard. And of course, I'm alluding to a national microchipping database. Because the Minister mentioned the legal requirement for all dogs to be microchipped, a central register of microchipped dogs would provide the traceability and the other benefits associated with the registration scheme I propose. And that's an alternative to part two of the bill. And you've seen my letter, I hope, to the Minister regarding that. Making best use of legal requirement to microchip puppies is something I've always felt passionate about, as I've already said it, and promotes the clear associated benefits for a long time. So that would be something for people to check. Is this puppy on the National Microchipping Register?
Okay, thank you. Beatrice Wishart.
The bill specifies that the registration requirements don't apply to a first owner of a litter of puppies who is not at the time resident in Scotland. And some stakeholders have suggested this may become a loophole. So I wonder how I get your thoughts on that. Is it something you've considered?
Just bear with me, I've got to find that. Well, here we are. The focus of Section 8 is on the first owner being a Scottish resident at time of wanting to advertise, sell or transfer. At this point, the litter would have to be registered. Now, I'm back to this business of the difficulty when we've got coming from abroad. Before we even get to that, people should have checked the puppy with its mother. That's the key. If somebody has got, I mentioned Romania and Southern Ireland, if they're bringing them out with and importing them, you have to have seen it with its mother. Now, I know there's criminal ways to try to get around that by having a false bitch with it and so on, but that's key to it in the first instance. That if somebody wanting to acquire a puppy says there's something amiss here, right? It's either not registered, or I haven't seen a registration for this, or I haven't seen it with its mother. Alarm bells. This is not fit. This is something wrong here. I'm not proceeding, or I'm going to make further inquiry.
Okay.
Thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. Just looking at the history of this bill briefly.
I was a young woman at the beginning of this.
I'm sure,
you know?
Sure you were, Ms. Graham. one of the requirements in a previous version of the bill was that the registration scheme, the registration scheme would be a requirement in a previous version of the bill, but it's now at the discretion of ministers. I wonder if you can explain the consideration that went into that, and are the powers in the bill necessary?
Well, I mean, I want to get this bill through, so I have to carry a lot of people with me, including the government, so I've made this lighter touch. I started out all those years ago in my youth where, you know, there was going to be penalties and everything else, and I decided, you know, that there's an awful lot has changed in that time. A lot has changed in terms of inflation, the pressures on local government, the pressures on budget, so I've got to be realistic. So what's important to me is to get through the education part. That's why I'm prepared to compromise on others. So that's why this is a lighter touch registration. Oh, I'd love it to be tougher, but you have to fit in with the times, and you have to fit in with what is practicable in terms of legislation. And what I think I've ended up with, and the caveat about registration in the light perhaps of national microchipping system, means that this, I hope, can become law and work. I'm not interested in legislation for its own sake. I want it to change what's happening out there for puppies and owners. And that's why the registration scheme became a lighter touch. And that's why I've even moved a bit further as I've gone along the road.
Thank you.
Rhoda Grant.
You talked about your letter to the Minister about this section of the bill. Can I just ask quickly whether you've had a response?
No.
You haven't had a response yet. Okay. Can I also maybe then ask, so we're making the assumption that the Scottish Government would prefer a registration system based on microchipping. Do you have any idea of how that would work and whether stakeholders would be happy?
I've been as specific as that about, okay. You know, they've alluded to the microchipping system, national database being something that would be useful. I don't think they've gone so far, to the best of my knowledge, and let me just check, in saying that it would be the equivalent to. But it's a better step than having none at all. Okay. So we don't at the moment. Yes, Ross.
If I could just quickly come in, that the 2016 affirmative instrument that introduced the mandatory microchipping, in the policy note, it says that this system could help to deter opportunistic dog theft by making it harder to sell such stolen dogs on. It could help to trace those breeding or dealing significant numbers of dogs illegally without a licence, or those breeding irresponsibly. So that makes the point that there is about whether or not it's a viable alternative, and the government in 2016 was acknowledging it would have that value in its policy note. And you asked about organisations. I know that that Battersea commented on the potential for microchipping to really aid traceability, okay, which is what Part 2 seeks to achieve.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. So we don't really have an idea of how that would work as an alternative system at the minute.
Well, they could do it, but what I'm hoping the committee would do, if it takes the view that, I don't want to preempt you, but if it takes the view that you might be supportive of this bill at stage one, if I give an undertaking about part two, subject to the government, this would be a good example for the committee to push the government through with a national microchipping database, because, as I say, this has been on the cards now for 6 years. And I think it would be a good opportunity to push this forward. And that would be another step forward to people identifying traceability of dogs for a whole range of reasons. Control of dogs notices could be on it. You know, I brought that forward. Control of dogs notices, information about where the dog came from. So a lot of stuff can be, if you've got the right system, I'm not technocrat, but a lot of system can be added to the proper system, more information about the dogs, to have traceability throughout Scotland on a rolling basis and on a national basis. So I think it's a great opportunity for the committee to push the government along this road if they're going to, you know, say registration is too onerous.
Sorry, just I understand that, and that, yeah, on the face of it appears simple, but there's different organisations that have microchipping registers, and I don't know if you've had any discussions with them about trying to pool this all into a national register. Obviously, they make money out of it. It's commercial business.
I'll let Ross come. I haven't had specific, because microchipping has come on as a sort of ancillary to this bill introduced by the minister, actually, in response to the committee. That was the first time microchipping was mentioned in evidence, but can I just pass to Ross?
Just also mention that the 2016 legislation on microchipping, it doesn't necessarily say it needs to be a central database, but it does say the proposed legislation, which is now in place, requires standardised types of microchips, standardised information to be kept on the database, appropriate access to the data held, and systems for cross-referring between different microchip databases. So it's not to say that it would just, the only possibility is a central database. It would be about existing databases having the capacity to cross-refer, which is what the government envisaged in 2016.
Yeah.
Just a tiny question. Do you know if that's been implemented,
no,
given that legislation happened?
The affirmative instrument regulations have been implemented, and that the annex of Christian Graham's letter to the minister are the details of all the microchipping requirements that are currently in place. We can send you those regulations if that's helpful.
I mean, I'd be very happy for the committee to pursue, you know, either cross-referencing or a national microchipping database. I mean, I think that would be superb, excellent, and move a long way towards assisting this legislation and this code.
We've got a number of supplementaries in this. It's obviously quite an interesting subject. We've got Rachel Hamilton and then Ariane Burgess and Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Whilst we know that... I've forgotten what I was going to say.
It's fine.
Thank to you, Ms. Hamilton.
So basically, a number of people. This was, as you said, this wasn't part of the bill, but as you said, it could be something that could be part of the bill.
But that's a new thing. And this specifically hasn't been consulted on. Hasn't been consulted on, this migrant shipping bit in part two. So therefore, while some stakeholders mentioned it, and the Minister mentioned it, and you've now written to the Minister to clarify some of her comments, does this mean that you'd have to go back to stakeholders to consult on this specific...
No. I mean, if you're going to go down this... Well, we're at the position where I'm keen on part one, right? But if you want to pursue something about microchipping in the bill, it's open to the committee to take evidence. It's open to the committee to take evidence on the government. It's the government that introduced this in the evidence. I sat here and the minister introduced microchipping, the line about microchipping. So you can always take evidence at stage two. If they wanted to amend to put it in, you can take evidence on it. And can I also say, we're looking at the regulations, the extract, the microchipping dogs got the regulation 2016. And if you look at those, the details to be recorded are substantial. And they're already, this is already enforced, but they've not got this in the sense of having it so that we can cross-reference. So you've got things like the full name and address of the keeper, the contact telephone number, email address, the fact the keeper is also a breeder, the fact that the keeper of the dog is a person who holds a breeding licence, the name of the local authority which issued the breeder's licence, a whole list of things are already there.
But what if... So the Minister understands that, as Rhoda Grant said, that there are a number of microchipping databases already in operation. They just don't include some of that information about the breeders. How can this achieve adding on those parts if those are operated in a commercial interest?
I'm not looking to do that. I'm not looking to add on. My thrust was for a registration of, as we have registration, we have every cow in Scotland, every sheep's got a number, you know, a registration for each puppy or transfer. This has been added as the government...
We're at risk of falling down a rabbit hole in the possible...
Well, rabbits haven't registered, are they? I don't know, maybe they are.
We're going to do a search and replace rabbit with dog for the next piece of legislation. But I think we're not at the stage where we're considering microchipping.
No.
We're still looking at stage one, which yours is about a registration scheme. What could happen is that at stage two, amendments would come forward to potentially look at this, but it would be for me as the convener to decide whether that was appropriate, whether those amendments would be taken forward.
Yes.
So rather than this expand too much, can we try and keep it to what we've got in front of us? Because the database and microchipping is a whole different topic.
Can of worms.
Yeah, please, thank you.
Can of database.
Ariane Burgess.
Thanks. Having said that, I do have a supplementary on microchipping, but actually maybe in support of the register, because we had evidence from Libby Anderson on the 20th of September, and she was explaining that while microchipping improves traceability of the individual dogs, a register could ensure that not only the traceability, but also the transparency and accountability of the breeder is understood. And also, other witnesses have provided evidence on unscrupulous dealers switching out microchips to falsify where the animal has come from. So I see your letter and your kind of possible openness to microchipping, but I would ask how could those things be prevented if microchipping was, if we were relying on that for the traceability?
I'm not a registration scheme, but if the fact that a registration scheme is not going to be acceptable to the committee, I wouldn't want stage one in this bill to be sabotaged. I don't mean sabotaged, but to fall by the wayside because of that. I mean, obviously, I want a registration scheme. However, I would say to Ariana Burgess, it's discretionary. It does say in the bill, if I go back to it, let me get the bill, the registration. It says, very important, the Scottish ministers may, by regulations, prohibit the first owner from that. May by regulation. So I was leaving a flexibility to them at a timing suitable, because I do accept the economic pressures on government and local authorities, and I've got to be realistic. because the prime purpose, as I repeat, to repeat and bore you, is to educate and acquiring. Registration is an important part, and I'm pleased that you support it. And I put it in because I think it's important. But if push comes to shove, and there is some push going forward about cross-referencing microchipping, I can see a way forward to satisfy us that there is some traceability of puppies and dogs in Scotland. May not be the best solution, but it's part of a solution.
Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. I won't pursue, because it was a sup about microchipping, because it related to traceability of dogs in livestock worrying, but it's not part of this at this time, so I won't pursue that.
Thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
So you mentioned there the cost and the pressure on local authority for enforcement, and I just wondered if you think that after all the conversations that we've just been having, that the estimations in your own financial memorandum might exceed the ones that you've suggested. How did you come to those figures?
Well, I'm going to refer to the financial memorandum at page 11, and there are the details, paragraph 61, the estimated cost to the Scottish Ministry to have the register and £60,000 to maintain the register. There may be a cost to Scottish ministers for producing guidance. This is expected to be minimal and met from existing budgets. And it lists a whole lot of things that come to it and goes down to the cost of publicity. So the financial memorandum, there are details about costs that may be acquired. And of course, in terms of government funding and in terms of local government funding, central government funding, these are gross costs, and I sort of cut off my prime there about net costs, because there's a cost to the public purse of abandoned animals, there's a cost to the public purse of animals that behave badly, there's a cost to local authorities about policing these things, and indeed some local authorities, I've seen submissions, said they could see the benefits of educating the public to be aware before they get it. There's less pressure on them, for example, with dogs that are out of control and so on, because we've nipped it off at the bud at the beginning, in a sense, by making sure the animal's in the right place with the right person at the right time. So these are gross costs.
So the cost of £1,500 per local authority, it says it would range for local authorities between £60,000 and £90,000 a year, or £1,500 per full-time role. But Glasgow City Council have made the point that with the additional demands that just may not cover it, and you know, it's very difficult to top up any additional resource costs that a local authority may need to put forward to ensure that enforcement is carried out. But they also have you're also asking them to do additional things to what they're currently doing, and a lot of them I think are concerned that's going to be a burden to them.
Before I ask Ross to go into the specifics of the actual figures, that's why I made it discretionary. That's why my answer to Ms Burgess, I said, you know, I'm aware of inflationary pressures on government and local authorities at this time. They've got, much as I love animals, people, you know, homes for people and so on, are top of the pops, top of the list. So that's why it was discretionary, bearing in mind, especially as economic circumstances have changed and inflation was raging, particularly last year, still high. So that is why it was discretionary. It is also why I am prepared, in terms of part two, if with some alternative that the government feels the cost of registration would be cumbersome, to move it, with the caveat of moving on with some kind of cross-referencing of microchipping. I'm very, very aware of costs to local authorities, but on the specific figures, I'll pass to Ross. But in general, that was my policy view of it, you know, because you've got to be realistic. You can't say to local authorities, this is a whiz-bang system, I just want you to do it, I don't care what it costs. I do care what it costs. Yeah. Ross.
Just to acknowledge that estimating the cost on local authorities was
very challenging, the most challenging part of the financial memorandum, I would suggest. And paragraph 50 of the financial memorandum sets that out because it was partly based on evidence received last session to the Public Audit Committee when it was doing post-legislative scrutiny on Christine Graham's previous bill. And there was a huge range of responses from local authorities on how they approach these issues, on the number of different roles that individual members of staff can hold. So that's hyperlinked from the financial memorandum, but I can provide that in full to the committee just to give a sense of the range of estimates and challenges highlighted by local authorities.
And even at paragraph 52, there's the cost that we have in relation to an animal welfare officer and so on. So, you know, so far as it's been practicable, we've looked at that, but I have been aware and very, very conscious that I don't want to burden local authorities with additional costs in this time when pressures are on their budgets. That's why, as I said, I made it discretion in the government if and when they introduced the registration scheme.
And the other thing I just wanted to ask you about is that there could be, because of some sort of cost concerns, inconsistency across local authorities. For example, in the constituencies that we represent, there might be extra requirement for cross-border enforcement. And I just wondered if you had or could take into account some of the differences in challenges that local authorities would have to face. And that is obviously increasing resource requirement.
I think some of the details from some of the local authorities from memory that were used as an evidence base include some of the distinct challenges. I think cross-border issues was one of them. The other thing that was very difficult to estimate, so we didn't attempt it, was any savings from enforcement over a period of time.
We know there'll be some, but you know, we'd just be plucking figures, and I won't do that. But as I say, in the general picture of things, well aware of the costs from local authorities, well aware there could be benefits to local authorities, but this is not the time at this very juncture in this year or next year to burden them with additional costs when they've got so much to deal with, and I'm aware of that.
Thank you.
Thank you. We've no further questions, so it just leaves me to thank you very much.
Thank you.
Christine Graham and your NGBU colleagues for providing evidence today. And I suspend the meeting until 11:25 for a comfort break. We now move on to our next agenda item, which is a consideration of the Draft Plant Health Fees Forestry Scotland Amendment Regulation 2023. And I welcome Lorna Slater, the Minister for Green Skills, Circular Economy and Biodiversity, and her officials, Clorinda Burrell, Tree Health Policy and Implementation Officer from Scottish Forestry, and David Corrigal is the solicitor from the Scottish Government, that I invite the Minister to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for taking time today to consider the draft SSI, the Plant Health Fees Forestry Scotland Amendment Regulations 2023. The regulations are being made to amend Scottish legislation in the field of plant health. Provision is introduced to extend the duration of an exemption from the requirements to pay fees for phytosanitary certificates for forestry exports from Scotland to Northern Ireland in certain circumstances under the UK Government's Movement Assistance Scheme. This will serve to support Scottish exporters post-transition period and ensure Scottish exporters retain access to the same support as their English and Welsh counterparts. As Northern Ireland remains part of the EU plant health system, exports from Scotland to Northern Ireland are required to fill EU entry requirements, including phytosanitary certificates. The Movement Assistance Scheme, funded by the UK Government, temporarily removes the requirement on exporters to pay fees associated with obtaining a phytosanitary certificate for exports of plants and plant products to Northern Ireland. The duration of the Movement Assistance Scheme has been extended to June 2025. The regulations that we're looking at today also make a minor wording amendment to Schedule 1 of the Plant Health Fees Forestry England and Scotland Regulations 2015 to provide greater clarity on the scope of activities which may be carried out in relation to audit inspections by competent authorities of professional operators authorised to issue GB plant passports. I consider that these regulations are therefore necessary and appropriate, and my officials and I are happy to take any questions from the committee.
Thank you, Minister. Any members, any questions? No? We'll move on to our next agenda item, which is formal consideration of the motion to approve the instrument, and invite the Minister to move motion S6M 10920. That the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee recommends that the Plant Health Fee Forestry Scotland Amendment Regulation 2023 be approved.
I move the motion. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Does any member wish to debate the motion? No. Is the committee content to recommend approval of this instrument? Thank you. And finally, is the committee content to delegate authority to me to sign off our report on our deliberations on this affirmative SSI? Thank you. That completes consideration of the affirmative instrument. I thank the Minister and our colleagues for attending this morning. I'll briefly suspend to allow the witnesses to leave the room.
Thank you very much.
Our next agenda item is consideration of three negative SSIs, the Rural Support, Simplification and Improvement Scotland Regulation 2023, the Animal Welfare and Food Safety International Professional Qualification Recognition Agreement Implementation Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations 2023, and the Common Organisation of the Markets in Agricultural Products, Fruit and Vegetables Amendment Scotland Regulations 2023. Do any members have any comments on these instruments? No? Everyone's content. Thank you. Our final item of business is consideration of consent notification for two UK SIs. The Windsor Framework Non-Commercial Movement of Pet Animals Regulations 2024, and the Official Control Extension of Transitional Period Miscellaneous Amendments Regulations 2023. Do any members have any comments on either of these notifications? No. Are members content to agree with the Scottish Government's decision to consent to the provision set out in the notifications being included in UK rather than Scottish subordinate legislation? Yes. Thank you. That concludes our business in public, and I now move the meeting into private session.